Hi viewers. So here we are in Apollo Cancer Institute today, having an exclusive one-on-one chit-chat with Dr. P. Vijayanand Reddy sir. So the most respected and the most sought after specialist into the oncology and at the same time cancer treatment here in Apollo Cancer Institute. Sir, very good evening to you, sir.
My pleasure.
Who gets cancer, and anyone can get cancer, although the risk goes up with age? Is that true?
Yeah, so unfortunately, if you look at the trend of various diseases in the past, two decades back, we used to say, oh, unko koi cancer aaya tha. So one of those corners, somewhere somebody is diagnosed of cancer was the news. Now you see anybody in the society, in the family or next door, you're seeing somebody is diagnosed of cancer. And similarly, if you look at the hospitals, none of the hospitals were focusing on cancer units or cancer departments. Now every hospital across the globe, in our country or across the globe, everyone has started developing cancer institutes, cancer hospitals, cancer wing in their multi-specialty wings. So in short, if you look at the cancer incidence is globally alarmingly increasing. Now we have in India 12 lakh new cancer cases being diagnosed in 2020, which is a very big number. And if you look at a number of cancer patients undergoing treatment at any given point of time, are around 80,000 to 1 lakh of people undergoing cancer treatment at any given point of time. So that is the scenario presently. So cancer is growing, unfortunately, and it does not look at the caste, creed, financial status or age. At any age cancer is going to happen, and it's not a disease of 70 years plus anymore. So there are different kinds of cancers that can happen at different age groups. That is the only difference, but otherwise any age person can develop cancers. So what we need to be aware, that anybody can develop cancer. So you need to be aware of certain symptoms, what you call them as warning symptoms, certain symptoms which hint you that there is some problem going on in your body, and then you need to address that symptom and find out what is this symptom due to. So that is what you need to be aware of.
How does cancer start, and is it genetic?
Now cancer is nothing but an abnormal growth of a cell. So there are millions of cells in your body, and each cell has got a control of cell division. For example, if you have an injury, let us say if an injury or skin, there is a skin gets broken, and then at the corner of that broken skin, the cell gets a signal to proliferate, and then till it the healing happens. Once the healing or the separated skin gets closure, the cell, it gets a signal not to divide further. So that is called cell division growth control. So one of those cells in any of the body loses the control of cell division, then it becomes an uncontrolled cell division. So that is called a cancer. So what really happens in your body, an external agent or underlying genetic mutations that can trigger any cell into a cancer cell, what we call that as a mutation. So in this cell, if the mutation happens, why does this mutation happen? It could be any reason. It could be an exogenous reason, for example, a chemical carcinogen, person working in a factory, or your dietary habits, or tobacco chewing or tobacco smoking, or underlying genetic issues. So that can cause some trigger in a normal cell. Then a mutation happens in the gene, and then the cell becomes mad. It starts proliferating from one cell to two cells, so 100 to million, and that turns out to be a cancer.
Is cancer contagious, or is there any vaccine for cancer?
Cancer is never, never, ever contagious. For example, tuberculosis is contagious. An infection or a syphilis is contagious, but cancer is never contagious. That's a myth. I would strongly tell my patients and attenders, never be away from a cancer patient. In fact, the patients, attenders can harm the patients, but patient himself will never harm an attender. So in other words, from a cancer patient, disease will not spread to a normal individual. Similarly, but if a patient is in close contact with a normal individual, if a normal individual has got some infection, that infection can transmit to a cancer patient. So that you need to understand. Cancer is never contagious. By touching a cancer, you will never have disease from the patient to yours. So the patient, when undergoing treatment, this is a common myth, then he will be separate. How he or she is asked to sit in a separate room, his utensils and clothes are separated. That is absolutely not required. They can mingle with children, they can eat with the rest of the family, they can be with the rest of the family. So vaccine is nothing but you develop certain antibodies against certain viruses. So there are viruses which cause cancer. The most common viruses which cause cancer are mainly two. One is human papilloma virus, which is called HPV virus. The other one is HBsAg antigen, which causes liver cancer. So human papilloma virus causes cervical cancer and HBsAg virus causes liver cancer. For both the viruses, we have vaccination, which is very much available. And I would always suggest everyone to go ahead and go get vaccinated for HBsAg vaccine for both males and females, whereas for HPV vaccine should be given for young girls before they get married. So the three doses of this vaccine would prevent these girls from developing cervical cancer by 95% to 99%. Similarly, HBsAg vaccine would prevent anyone from developing HBsAg related liver cancer.
Can cancer be cured at all the cancers?
See, that's another myth, that once you are diagnosed of cancer, people think that that's the end of life. It is so unfortunate. It is never end of life. And most of the irony is, people, when they have symptoms, warning symptoms and signals that trigger them, tell them there is something going wrong, they get scared of even going for investigations, thinking that probably they might be diagnosed of cancer, and they unnecessarily delay the investigations, they delay the diagnosis, and early stage cancer will become late stage. So never ever get scared of this cancer diagnosis. It is better to get diagnosed at the earliest and get the treatment, stipulated treatment, whatever the oncologist would suggest, and get rid of it. There are millions and millions of people who have been treated and cured of cancer, and these patients are leading absolutely a normal life. See, I've treated children 20, 30 years back and who got married, and they themselves also have children, parenthood, everything as normal as any other individual in the society. In fact, we have written a book called I Am a Survivor, where the cancer patients who have been treated and cured shared their stories and mentioned that they are leading an absolutely normal life. So cancer is certainly curable. Only thing that we should understand, that if you go into late stages, once the disease has spread to other parts of the body, then it becomes difficult to get cured. Otherwise, most of these cancers, in fact, 65% to 70% of the cancers, what we see day to day, are all cured.
What are the stages of cancer and what do they mean, doctor?
So stage is nothing but when you know the tumor arising, for example, a small tumor arising in the tongue, which is not spread to other parts of the body, we call it as stage 2. If the tumor increases by more than 2 centimeters, then we call it as stage 2. Stage 1 going to stage 2. From there, if you develop a lymph node from the tongue lesion, it goes to the lymph node, we call it as stage 3. But from there, if it spreads to lungs, bones or elsewhere in the body, we call it as stage 4. So most of the cancers can be diagnosed in stage 1 and stage 2, and these patients can get more than 90% cure rates. It could be anywhere. It could be in the breast, it could be in the intestines, it could be in the mouth, it could be in the throat. All stage 1, stage 2 cancers are almost get cured by more than 90%.
Does cancer have any symptoms so that they can avoid getting into any kind of a problem, doctor?
So this is what I was telling you about warning signs and symptoms that you should always be aware of. It is available very much. We call it as a word called caution, C-A-U-T-I-O-N. If you Google it, then you would understand what does C-A-U-T-I-O-N mean. In brief, caution is nothing but the early signs and symptoms of cancer, which is something like bladder disturbances or bowel disturbances. Like when you have a constipation which is not getting relieved in a week or 2 weeks time, when you have diarrhea which is not getting relieved in 1 week or 2 weeks time, you certainly need to see a doctor. Similarly, urination, if you have a thin stream of urine or more number of times that you are passing urine, or there is a blood in the urine. So these are the symptoms that you should never ignore and you should see a doctor. Similarly, you have an ulcer in the mouth, which normally small ulcers will heal in 1 week to 2 weeks time. If the ulcer does not heal for more than 2 weeks, you should certainly go and meet the doctor. You might find an ulcer, you might find that ulcer turning into cancer. Similarly, you have some hoarseness of voice, that normally when you have cold, the voice becomes hoarse. But if the voice hoarseness does not get relieved in 2 to 3 weeks time, you should certainly see a doctor. And if you have any swallowing difficulty, then also, if normally you, again you have soreness in the mouth or infection, then you have difficulty in swallowing. But if it does not get relieved in 2 to 3 weeks time, you should certainly see a doctor. Then coming to the cough, when somebody has a cough, it is quite natural and normal to have cough. But if the cough does not get relieved in 2 to 3 weeks time, you should certainly get investigated and meet a doctor. So then these kind of, some people have the habit of taking antacids when they have acidity, pain in the upper abdomen, and they say just acidity hai, just take an antacid and get relief. So that kind of a things, if it goes on beyond 2 to 3 weeks, you should certainly get investigated. By a simple test called endoscopy, you would find some lesions in the food pipe or in the stomach. So these are kind of, and another important warning sign is a lump anywhere in the body. So especially the breast. If you have a lump in the breast, and most of these are painless, you should always see a doctor to find out whether that lump is a cancerous or non-cancerous lump. 80% of the lumps in the breast are non-cancerous, but that does not mean that you ignore them because they are painless. Most of the cancer lumps start as a painless lumps. So you should see a doctor and get investigated and find out whether it is cancerous or non-cancerous.
Across the globe, what is the most common type of cancer that kills men only?
See, there are cancers in men in our country or in the world. In our country, let us say, because of our smoking habits and chewing habits, oral cancers and head and neck cancers, that means throat cancers, are very, very common. And then the food pipe cancer, then intestinal cancers are very, very common in men in our country. And next is the lung cancers. In the Western world, it is colonic cancers, intestinal cancers, and prostatic cancer are very common because they do not chew tobacco. That is unfortunately seen more common in our country. So we get oral cancers and throat cancers.
So worldwide, what is the most common cancer that kills women?
In women, the most common cancer is the breast. And in India, it is mostly, it was cervical cancer. Now the breast has overtaken cervical cancer. So if you take across the globe, breast cancer is the most common cancer which we need to be really, really careful of.
What is the most common form of cancer in all human beings?
So this is what it is. The commonest cancer in women is breast. The commonest cancer in men are lung cancers and head and neck cancers.
Tobacco does causes what percentage of cancer deaths around the world, Doctor?
Across the globe, tobacco related cancers are almost 35 to 40%, which is a very high number. So even in our country, the statistics say that almost 47% of the cancers what we see in India are related to tobacco. Chewing tobacco, smoking tobacco, whatever form of tobacco, we have a highest incidence of tobacco related cancers because we got a very bad habit of chewing tobacco.
So what viruses cause cancer as a result of chronic infection?
I already mentioned there are two most important viruses which have human papilloma virus, which causes cervical cancer. 95% of the cases of cervical cancer are related to HPV infection. So we have vaccine for it. You should always advise children before they get married, ideal time to get vaccinated. And you can prevent vaccine in 95% of the cases. The next virus which causes cancer is HBsAg virus, which causes liver cancer. 70 to 80% of the liver cancers are related to HBsAg virus. So there is a vaccine available for this virus too. You should get vaccinated. There are 3 doses which are required, and that gives you a long life immunity. Apart from that, there are some other viruses which can cause viruses. One is the nasopharyngeal cancer. It is Epstein-Barr virus, which we do not have a vaccine because the incidence of Epstein-Barr virus related nasopharyngeal cancer is not that common. So as of now, we have only two vaccines for two common viruses, HPV and HPSAG.
What are the kind of foods that are linked to colon cancer, doctor?
See, colon cancer is as simple as that. Whatever you take has to go through the colon. So when you take any kind of a diet, especially non-vegetarian diet, spicy diet, and red meat, and when you have fried kind of food, any food which is fried up makes the food carcinogenic. So these kind of stuff would certainly increase the incidence of colonic cancer. So if you look at the Western world, one of the common cancers was colonic cancer, and they found out that these are the reasons why we are developing colonic cancers. So they modified their dietary habits. They started taking some kind of a green salad, some kind of a vegetarian food along with this non-vegetarian diet, and that increases the fiber content of the food. That protects the intestines from these carcinogens which you are also taking along with the vegetarian diet. So make it a habit of taking a salad, green salad, high fiber vegetarian diet along with this non-vegetarian diet, then the colonic cancer chances would significantly reduce.
What is the most deadly form of all cancers in the female reproductive system?
I always say, whenever I address women, that God has been very, very partial to womanhood. Most of the cancers in women are highly, highly curable compared to the cancers what we see in men. So if you look at the cancers of the uterus, cancers of the cervix, cancer of the breast, cancer of the ovary, all these cancers are highly curable. Not only that, in women, most of these cancers which I just mentioned, they give you plenty of warning signs and symptoms. They knock your door and tell you there is something going wrong, like a lump in the breast. You should never ignore that. Then there is some discharge happening. It could be white discharge, it could be red discharge. When you meet your husband, there is some bleeding happening. All these are warning symptoms of cervical cancer and uterine cancer. So when you go to a doctor and identify, then you can easily diagnose these tumors at an early stage, and these are all highly, highly curable. And also, what we advise in women is just an annual checkup every year after the age of 34. Simple mammogram, an ultrasound of the abdomen, and a pap test, which are all done as an outpatient, you would detect stage 0 and stage 1 cancers which are not actually causing any symptoms to you. So I don't think there is something which is really deadly in women cancers, and most of them are giving you early warning signs and symptoms. They are detectable early, they are highly curable.
So what is the name of for cancers of the blood?
So we call it as blood cancers, and there are plenty of different types of blood cancers. Some are very easy to treat, and some are very aggressive, and we need high end treatments, high dose chemotherapies, bone marrow transplants. All these are there is spectrum of blood cancers. You have leukemia, what you call it as leukemias, or blood cancers, or liquid cancer. So these are varied type of tumors which range from taking simple tablets to bone marrow transplants.
Very importantly, sir, post COVID-19, what preventions or what instructions should be followed by a doctor?
So cancer is not going to be affected with the COVID. Never, if you have any kind of symptoms that are troubling you, you should never delay just because the COVID pandemic is going on. You should, most of the times what happened during the pandemic time is most of the patients, although they had symptoms, they try to postpone because of the fear of COVID. COVID, whether it is going to cause problems to you or not, but if you delay the diagnosis of cancer, you would definitely certainly going to have serious problems. So never get worried about the COVID. You do the reasonable precautions of wearing a mask and maintaining social distancing, but never ignore the symptoms. You have to go to the cancer hospitals. Any of the cancer hospitals were functioning all through the pandemic time, and even now every cancer hospital is open to patients. All the doctors are available. you have to come to the doctor and find out whether you have a problem, serious problem or not. And once you are diagnosed of cancer, we are routinely taking care of these patients. Patients require surgery, we are doing it. Patients require chemotherapy, we are doing it. Patients who require radiation, we are doing it. Taking all the precautions to prevent COVID getting infected to our patients. And the doctors are protected. Doctors, personnel, staff nurses are all taking personal care to protect themselves and protect the patients as well.
Regarding the Cure Foundation, it has been your brainchild, your, you know, your dream project. So how it has come to you? So our viewers actually wanted to know more about your Cure Foundation.
So Cure Foundation is started way back in 2003 when I realized that children who develop cancers need the best possible care, and these children need sophisticated gadgets to take care of these cancers. And as children have got the tumors in children, or cancers in children, are highly curable, much better than the adult cancers. As I said, 65% of the cancers in adults get cured, whereas in children 85% of these cancers get cured. So they need to be get a proper treatment. So to keep, and when the children have get the disease, they have done anything, they have not done anything wrong by themselves, why should they be cursed because they are diagnosed of cancers? Those people need a definitive treatment, the best treatment in the world, because they are going to get rid of the disease, and with a proper scientific approach. So to keeping that in mind, whenever a child gets diagnosed, when the parents are financially not able to take care of these children because of financial issues, we take care of them under the foundation, Cure Foundation, and we take care of these patients completely free of cost or a subsidized treatment, and we get them cured. So that is very, very gratifying. That is the main component of Cure Foundation. And the second other important thing that the Cure Foundation does is to create awareness in the society. See, cancer is very much curable, provided if you diagnose them in stage 1 and stage 2. So people should be aware what are the signs and symptoms. What women should never be ignored. Women should never ignore, because they will be taking care of the family. Even though they get certain signs and symptoms, they try to ignore, postpone the symptoms, and they come in a very advanced stage. So to create awareness in different kinds of societies, and to tell people anybody can get cancer, so we approach societies, women organizations, sports tournaments, different kinds of awareness tournaments or campaign or camps. We do every 2 months, every fortnight, some kind of awareness programs, meeting every section of the society, so that we can diagnose cancer at an early stage.
We are very much thankful to you, sir. Thank you so very much for your precious time. But before we leave, we would love to know, Apollo Cancer Institute has been pioneering in the service of, you know, curing cancer patients. So do you have any message to say?
Apollo has always been in the forefront, and we have an exclusive oncology department in Hyderabad and across the country. The biggest oncology network in the country is with Apollo, and we have a national tumor board. Any complex patient requires any kind of special treatment will be sent to a center where they are experts in that particular area, and that is very, very important. We all work as a group, and we have an excellent networking system. And as far as the infrastructure is concerned, whichever comes in across the world, in the best of the best hospitals across the globe, in the European or Western world, our chairman is very, very keen to get that kind of a best technology to our doorsteps, so that our Indians should get the best possible care. So as far as the infrastructure is concerned, we are on par with the best of the best cancer units in the world. And added to that, we need people to take care of this and to deal with this infrastructure. I'm proud to have an extremely good, talented and ethical, scientifically approaching team with me to deal with any kind of cancer in the world. So the other thing which comes into the mind of the people is, when they go to Apollo, the cost is forbidding. So please don't be under that impression. We have packages for all sections of the society, and also that we have foundation which supports them, which gives them subsidized treatment as well. So irrespective of the financial status, every patient gets the best treatment and the best outcome. Thank you.
Thank you so very much for your time, doctor.